Ah, Nintendo, one of my favorite video game companies of all time. The first Nintendo console I ever touched in my life was the Nintendo GameCube, and ever since then, Nintendo has always had a place in my heart. My favorite games from Nintendo are all memorable for many reasons, either for having a great story, good graphics, cool characters, or fun mechanics and gameplay. However, a common reason why Nintendo games are so memorable and fun are for its final bosses. A final boss tests you on everything you've learned from the game so far and brings you a challenge that you'll never forget. Some of my favorite Nintendo games are even solely because of the final bosses that are included in these games. The best green light to have on your game is to finish a game with a positive impact that you'll never forget. Final bosses are perfect for leaving a game on a good note, and so today I got down to thinking, just what are the best final bosses in Nintendo games? Well, one opinion certainly can't form a list like this, so I decided to call on a good friend of mine.
I was just tiptoeing in my turquoise Lamborghini. Daniel hit me up and was all like, "Hey Corson, you trying to be in this project I'm working on?" I was like, "Hell no, get your money up, King." But then, I had a change of heart and thought, you know what? Yeah. Yeah, I'll do it.
yeah, sure, Mr. Grinch change of heart head ass. Anyways, yes, for today's top 10 video, I brought Corson Drax on board with me because he knows some of these final bosses more than I do, and I've been wanting to collaborate with him for a while now. For this list, we'll be counting our most favorite, challenging, impactful, and memorable final bosses from Nintendo. Remember that this is just our opinion, so if you don't agree with something, that's just completely fine. If we missed anything, it's either because we've never played it, or it's in the honorable mention section. Another rule is one final boss per series. The different Mario series like Donkey Kong, Yoshi's Island, and every other Mario series like RPG, Dream Team, Miniland, Mayhem, or just all the series that Mario has won't apply to that rule. And I guess without further ado, here is our top 10 Nintendo final bosses.
Kicking off the list, we have Oh no. Punching off the list, we have Matt from Wii Sports Boxing. Arguably the toughest fight one could ever face. With a chin of iron and fists of fury, this guy is a lot more than some rando off MiiMaker. That bald head has seen more blood and tears than Prime Mike Tyson. And this guy doesn't even need to bite off ears! These AI-generated combinations are some of the deadliest anyone will ever see. Only few will see Matt standing across from them in the ring, and even fewer will live to tell the tale. This guy has put more asses on a mat than your local yoga instructor. Matt doesn't just knock you out, no, he takes your soul with him. I don't think there's anything more intimidating that this man could do. Nope, wait, there is. Nah, this is more intimidating. Holy, he chucks those fuckers with such speed. I can't do this. This is scary as fuck. Look at this. Two at once, rapid fire. You gotta unlock Ultra Instinct to even keep up. But yeah, we had to give him a spot on this list. Felt like the perfect person to start us off. And I also didn't want to get on his bad side. Smash Bros. Brawl. Probably my favorite video game of all time. And who better to represent it than Mr. Taboo? The visuals on this fight are crazy. Seeing him teleport across the stage, and you try to just get that one kick in, and the way he just starts slamming the ground like a child having a temper tantrum, truly makes him an iconic final boss. Fighting this guy just makes you feel like you're the main character in an anime or something. Look at him just chilling above thinking he's Goku. Taboo has all forms of attack ready, coming at you from all kinds of different angles. Whether he's swooping down with the energy blade or throwing fireballs, this guy can create holograms of himself that can burn through anything. Superpowers galore, my friends. Subspace Emissary is undeniably one of the most iconic single-player experiences of our childhood, and it still holds up to this day. The bosses from this game hardly miss, and Taboo is no exception. They filled him with powers, turning giant, laser eyes, I don't even know what you call this other shit. Trying to deal with all this whilst depleting a health bar is not only a great fucking time, but also makes for an exciting and interesting challenge. I'd argue he's a number one boss from the Smash series as a whole, and is definitely deserving of a spot on the list.
Coming in at number 8, we have the Emperor Bulblax from Pikmin 1. I decided to choose this final boss from the Pikmin series mainly due to the difficulty and overall impact this boss presents. After collecting 29 out of 30 ship parts to repair Olimar's ship, one still remains in the final area of the game. Once completing the confusing puzzle showcased in this area, you then encounter the final boss of Pikmin being the Emperor Bulblax. The Emperor rises from the ground and is immediately intimidating for how giant the creature is. He has several attacks that can crush almost your entire army in seconds, and he can just lunge himself into the air and literally sit on your whole army killing them. He can also eat your Pikmin by swinging his long-range tongue around, eating several of them if you aren't careful. His health is also one of the largest out of any Pikmin enemy, making him a long, bulky nightmare to defeat. You can counter the Emperor by using the bomb rocks around the area for him to eat. Once he eats these bomb rocks, he becomes stunned and now is your chance to attack him. As his health lowers, he becomes more aggressive and unpredictable, easily turning this fight into one of the most challenging experiences of any Nintendo game. In my experience of fighting the Emperor Bulblax, I was honestly overwhelmed by its size and range of attacks that it had. I had a full army of 100 Pikmin, and by the end of the fight, I only had like 20, so yeah, this boss is a nightmare to deal with if it's your first time challenging it. Even stunning it with the rock bombs, you'd be lucky to even do a significant amount of damage here. Oh, and did I mention that it can regenerate health? Yeah, that's why this beast deserves a number 8 spot on the list. Taking the number 7 spot, we have Baby Bowser from Yoshi's Island. Who would have thought a baby version of Bowser would be more intimidating and challenging than most battles with his adult self? After going through 6 worlds to find and save Baby Luigi, we encounter Kimmick and Baby Bowser. They refuse to give up Baby Luigi, so we fight Baby Bowser in his regular form. This fight is easy, as you just stomp on his head 3 times and the day is saved, right? Well, that's until Kimmick has one more trick up his sleeve, and uses magic on Baby Bowser, and out of nowhere he starts to become bigger and bigger until the castle collapses. The screen then becomes pitch black until our vision slowly starts to return to us. Here, we see the outside of a collapsing castle as a giant Baby Bowser rises up and unleashes a mighty roar as giant rocks start falling down. This fight is both badass and intimidating right off the bat, with a guitar going hard as fuck while Baby Bowser unleashes his attacks being flying rocks and his fire breathing. If there had to be any Nintendo boss that screams adrenaline rush, it would be Baby Bowser. In order to attack Baby Bowser, you have to throw and aim your eggs at him. Otherwise, he would just start to slowly run closer and closer to you, which is just straight up horrifying. Another anxious part of this fight is with flying rocks being thrown, it crushes your platforms, giving you very limited space to dodge anything, which brings in the difficulty, which is always a plus. Baby Bowser is nothing short of intimidating, terrifying, and anxiety-inducing, which is why Baby Bowser claims the number 7 spot on the list.
You know I had to get some Miniland Mayhem representation here. And World 8's final boss has every reason to be on here. The Ferris Wheel Donkey Kong fight. Where do I even begin? I remember chucking my DS and throwing my sketchpads trying to beat this fucker. But what an excellent final boss, might I add. Donkey Kong latches onto the Ferris wheel and starts launching rockets from above. Trying to maneuver the right angles with your wind-up mini Mario robots with obstacles to avoid was a blast. A dandy old time, if you will. Mario vs. Donkey Kong Miniland Mayhem is full of exciting bosses, so you know I had to include the final one. Speaking of Miniland Mayhem, there may be a video dropping sometime soon about that game as a whole. Hint, hint, obvious plug is obvious, shameless plug. What's that? It features Isaac Tings? Oh my god, I've said too much. Oh my god. Anyway, back to Donkey Kong. The alternating wheel and various rockets make this a very unique and challenging final boss. I have to mention this, which, by the way, this is one of the biggest reasons I decided to include this on the list. There are basically 2 battles in one. An entire final boss fight, followed by a final boss fight. Yes, motherfucker, the Super Sky Wheel is just extra. World 8, level 8, my friends, the final world and technically the final level. One of the best maps of them all, and it even has the Ferris wheel in the background for some very clever foreshadowing. Navigating your minis up this course using all the wacky power-ups as DK's fire slowly descends, this 2-part final boss is truly a work of art. a game where you build the pathway to the enemy? The concept is great, and I love the originality. Trying to cannonball your way through this shit was tricky, especially when Donkey Kong is there trying to turn back the clock to the fucking Great Revolution. Whilst your 9-year-old self is getting dizzy, the brainwashing doesn't end there as this hypnotic-ass music plays while you're just trying to skim your way through Kim Jong-un's plethora of children. Also, how the fuck is Pauline staying on this ride? This shit does a full circle jerk, pun intended, in like 3 seconds, whilst explosives are going off from below. This gotta be one durable-ass Ferris wheel. But yeah, the cutscenes before and after definitely make this a satisfying conclusion, and worthy of being ranked amongst the top 10 final bosses of Nintendo. I'm gonna pass it over to Daniel for a less deserving choice.
Introducing itself onto number 5, we have Grima from Fire Emblem Awakening. This final boss is nothing short of amazing. Fire Emblem Awakening is known to be the game that saved the Fire Emblem franchise because if it hadn't been for the successful sales of Awakening on the 3DS, it would have been the very last Fire Emblem game of the franchise. Knowing that means that Grima would have been the final boss of just the entire franchise, which makes this final boss even more impactful. The plot of Fire Emblem Awakening is a bit confusing, but in order for this final boss to even make sense, we must talk about it. Our story begins with Grima, the powerful fell dragon, overtaking the world of the future, killing Lucina's family and basically just everyone she cared for in general. Grima basically doomed her future, and so she pulled some Samurai Jack type of stuff and went back to the past to undo the future and save it. In order for the fell dragon Grima in the present day to gain his full potential, he possesses a human form of someone who is actually the main protagonist of the game, being Robin. In the bad future timeline that Lucina was in, the heroes lost against Grima and took over the land. Now our heroes must face Grima in an epic showdown to prevent the future from repeating itself and defeating Grima once and for all. However, defeating Grima is just no easy task. Grima is too powerful and literally almost one-shots our entire army in a matter of seconds. With Robin unconscious and all of our heroes literally dying, we are given hope by the power of friendships we made along the way. I know that kinda sounds like some Disney type of stuff, but it was cool. I mean, everyone that you met at the start of your journey just giving you that hope and just that final speech before you get back up, Ahmed, is just so cool. Robin does eventually wake up with the power of friendship and trust and blah blah blah, and with the help of Naga, who is a literal god of the world, restores everyone's health, and we have the final showdown with Grima. The best part of this final boss is the story and build up to the fight, along with the epic music accompanying it. It's very rare to see such a story in a Nintendo game, and is a nice breath of fresh air compared to fighting, Bowser for the 500th time because of Peach. The fight itself is challenging for how Grima's henchmen can rival your allies, and you'd have to be very careful with strategizing your unit's placements. I like Fire Emblem because it's like playing a strategic game of chess, and this fight just did not disappoint. The buildup, importance, difficulty, and overall satisfaction of defeating Grima and saving the world makes this final boss, in my opinion, deserve the number 5 spot on the list.
I know we're talking about the N64 and all, but you gotta give some credit for the visuals. I mean, come on! This polygon-looking animation was Marvel Studios quality back in the day. And hey, this still looks pretty awesome. The movement still holds up pretty well. You can barrel roll in between Ganon's legs, which is pretty clean. The ducking and weaving makes for a pretty great final boss. Ocarina of Time 2, my favorite from the Zelda series. Just when it's all over, you think you save Zelda, but no! This motherfucker comes right back to life. Round 2, bitches! You still want to get behind him and attack the weak spot, being that rainbow skittle-tainted tail. It's not the most complicated fight in the world, but it's certainly got memorability. You've got a lot of range and free space to move around. The platform looks cool with all the fire as the barrier. One thing I hate about this is once you defeat old Giggly Ganon, his nose physics start jiggling around all weird, like, ew, look at this shit. Don't do that on my screen. Probably got mad boogers in there. Zelda holds him off with her celestial magic, which just so happens to be proven useful after the fight. Like, yeah, thanks, Zelda. Make me put in all the work just so you can decide you're powerful again. After you're done slicing and dicing poor Gangrene, he hits the Harlem Shake and he's banished to the void, where he's trapped in the evil realm. Forever. Or until the next game comes out.
Gygas is the definition of what the fuck. He's our number 3 spot on the list, and if you have no idea what Earthbound/Mother is, well, prepare yourself. Gygas is the embodiment of evil. He He is the influence of it and might as well be the definition of it. We won't go too much into Gygax' origin story, as we'll mainly be discussing his Earthbound / Mother 2 appearance. If you want to know more about Gygax though, then check out this video and about his origins, cause honestly it really helps. In Earthbound, Gygax from the future has taken over the Earth and has conquered it. And so, get this, in order to save the past from history repeating itself, a random fly named BuzzBuzz comes from the future. He then seeks out a 10-year-old named Ness to defeat his galactic alien because Ness was actually prophesied to be Gygax. Gygax learns of this prophecy and decides to also travel back to the past to stop Ness. The final boss itself is weird as Ness teleports even further into the past where Gygax is in the womb and literally fights Gygax, well, in the womb. So essentially you're killing Gygax before he could even be born. That's... wow. That's why Gygax isn't an alien in this game, but some weird-looking red liquid that has a face. Yeah. Honestly, this whole fight is a mindfuck, as the visuals, music, and overall tone of this fight is just uncomfortable. Even in the final cave of Earthbound, before encountering Gygax, the entrance of the cave looks to, well... yeah, it's a vagina. Anyways, in order to fight Gygax, you can't because he's a literal fetus, so use Paulo, who is one of the main characters, to pray because... I don't know, I guess praying can vanquish an evil alien from who knows where now, apparently. I mean, I guess Gygax is, I guess, the devil, depicted as the devil in this series, so yeah, I guess that works. This is the only final boss of any Nintendo game where you just have to survive, because you literally can't attack Gygax, because, I mean, he's not alive yet, but as for Gygax's attacks, you just have to endure them and use whatever healing items you got. If your stats are shit, then, well, you're kind of screwed here. Why? Well, because entering the final cave in the game and being in the past, you can't really go back. Meaning, even if you do die, you'll just end up back in the final cave. After defeating Gygax, though, the day is saved, and... yippee, I guess. I can't really describe this final boss clearly, as it's just one huge mindfuck, but because of how unnerving, scary, challenging, and the build-up for the fight, it just has to be the number 3 spot on the list.
Even if you're not an RPG fan, this undeniably had to make the list. The Dark Bowser fight is crazy. Having Bowser on Bowser action whilst fighting each other with the same attacks was a really cool concept. It's like fighting a clone or an evil twin. Well, I guess Bowser was already evil, but this one is more evil! Roar! And the fact that you get to cross between fighting above ground and transitioning inside Bowser's body during the fight to see what Mario and Luigi are up to, this final fight has everything. Truly a cinematic masterpiece. Can't forget to mention Fawful, since they're still a huge part of this final battle. The visuals on this are insane. Bowser's KO punch was surely a satisfying way to finish him off as well. Obviously, we gotta mention the music. Inside Story's soundtrack is already known for being baller, but this is something else, my friends. Hearing this play as you take on this super being was mesmerizing. The only recorded instance of Bowser actually trying to save Peach. This final boss has everything, whether it's the build-up, cutscenes, or even just the amount of options you have for attacks. You can really have fun here. Two bosses in one, three characters to alternate between, truly an RPG masterclass. I could go on and on about how memorable this fight is, and after all that, Bowser actually changed. He went right back to trying to kidnap Peach and got hospitalized by the Mario Brothers. Wow, that is crazy. After all that, Mario and Luigi got some unreal plot armor though, I can't lie. Like, how? But yeah, as for the final boss and great battle mechanics, that's pretty much all there is to it. If you want to see more from Inside Story, shameless plug number 2, I may have a video dropping soon as well. What's that? It features Isaac Tings again? Oh no, I've said too much. Oh my god. That shit was meant to come out in 2021, by the way. Like I've had the script finished for like 3 years, but the original person was never able to write anything, so yeah, a replacement has been made, and I'll have to revise everything to fit the modern times, but yeah. Moving on to the number one final boss in all of Nintendo.
Before we unveil our top pick, here are some honorable mentions.
What you listening to, son?
I don't think you like it.
Well, why not? I like this new generation of music.
Thank you.
And here we are with the number one entry on this list being...
Bowser from Mario Kombat! That's right, ladies and gentlemen! Holy fuck, how are you supposed to beat this shit? Alright, maybe it's not that bad, you know? It can't be that hard, you know? Wait, what the fuck? How am I getting around this shit? What do I...
Yeah, anyways, it's actually Red from Pokemon Heart Gold and Soul Silver. If any final boss on this list had the definition of iconic, it would be Red. In the very first Pokemon games, Red, Blue, and Green, you play as the main protagonist being Red. After you finish these games and conclude Red's adventure, he is known as the very best. Move on to the sequel of these games, Gold, Silver, and Crystal, you play as the new protagonist known as Gold. Once you complete your adventure in those games as Gold, you have one more thing left to do, being to explore the final cave in the game, Mount Silver. This cave holds some of the most powerful and fearsome Pokemon, but the most challenging part of the cave isn't even in the cave itself, but rather at the top of the mountain where you find him, Red. The former protagonist that you played in the previous games is here, standing on the highest part of Mount Silver, looking in at the snowy area. Right off the bat, this is intimidating, but you approach him regardless, and he doesn't even say a word. Without warning, a battle starts, and you're essentially fighting your former self. Red is easily the coolest final boss of any Nintendo game because you're the one who basically brought Red to where he was at that point. You're fighting what you essentially created. Red's team includes Blastoise, Charizard, Venusaur, Snorlax, Lapras, and most iconic of all, Pikachu. This is what truly feels like a final test. Challenging the best trainer against your own team, finding out who is the real Pokemon Master. After this intense battle and defeating Red, he still says nothing and just disappears. This fight just leaves chills overall. Having to fight a previous version of yourself or just anything like that is chilling and cool in my opinion. Red vs. Gold will always be iconic, and even if you aren't the biggest Nintendo fan, you know this battle. It's why many love Generation 2 in the first place. However, I am counting this fight with Generation 4's Pokemon Heart Gold and Soul Silver, as it is a better version of Gold, Silver, and Crystal being the official remake for those games. Being intense, iconic, adrenaline-rushing, important, and leaving an overall impact in the gaming world, Pokemon Trainer Red deserves his rightful spot at being the best Nintendo final boss.
Well, Daniel, it's been a fun ride, but unfortunately, I've got another fun ride. To break down the garden gate, there's not much time left today.
Off he goes then, I suppose. Special shout out to Corson Drax for being a part of this video, and I hope you guys enjoy this video as well. Final bosses are almost essential to any Nintendo game, and I feel like it can either make or break a game sometimes. We always need to be tested on everything we learn, and final bosses are needed for that. It has been a while since I made a top 10 video, and I thought, eh, why not? And after making a Pikmin bosses video, I thought, you know, it'd be cool for, you know, just to make one for Nintendo final bosses. I like collaborative videos, and if you want to see more videos like this, just let me know. If you want to support me, just hit that subscribe button and like the video to see more videos like this. Anyways, I've been Daniel, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Peace.